first of all, thank you, Oleg, for accepting the invitation. It's really wonderful to have you here giving the colloquium today. And let me just give you a brief introduction about Oleg. So Oleg got his degree in chemistry from Moscow State University in 2003. Afterwards, he moved to EPFL in Switzerland, where he completed his PhD in 2007. Later, he spent a few years as a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Physics at the University of California in Berkeley and Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. And in September 2011, he started as an independent research group supported by the Swiss National Science Foundation. In 2012, he got awarded the prestigious ERC starting grant, and now he's a professor at EPFL. So the research interest of Oleg focuses on the theoretical and computational physics of two-dimensional materials and topological materials, and in particular, he has provided some extremely important results in two-dimensional systems, in topological systems, and in the chemically engineered graphene structures. So today, Oleg is going to tell us about in silico discovery of novel topological materials. Let me first say thanks so much, Oleg, for giving this talk today, for accepting the invitation. And with this, the floor is yours, and we look forward to your talk.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank you, Jose, and Peter for inviting me here. Of course, it would be great to come to Helsinki in person, but at least like this, it's quite easy to accept invitations, give talks, and I'm glad to see that there is quite a significant audience here. Let me share my screen with the presentation. So basically, what I'm going to talk about today is our efforts that are probably not the most recent ones on trying to do high throughput screening to find new topological materials. We did find some new materials, and that was basically some sort of a culmination for us for SILS, because we had a chance to lead a little bit of experimental research to coordinate experimental activities, and this is probably this was a dream for me as a theorist, and that resulted in these two papers where we found some kind of interesting materials that excited community. There are of course more recent examples, but now I think my group is in the transition from high throughput screening of materials to materials design. And that brings us, of course, to things like twisted bilayer graphene and all these more super lattices, but that would be a topic of a different talk. There is something in chat. Yes, okay. So that was a reminder from Jose. Oops, sorry. Okay, now I cannot let the chat window go. Okay, good. So, and then I would like also to conclude with a short discussion on magnetoresistance in topological and also in trivial materials, which basically brings us to some textbook knowledge of Ashcroft Merman level. I would like basically to show that very large non-saturating magnet resistance is a common property for many materials, and typically it's just a normal mechanism for charge carrier compensation open orbit. So there is actually very little topological physics as we realize right now. Okay, so I would like to start by showing this kind of a roadmap that I was lazy to stretch beyond 2018, but nevertheless, this is what is going on in the field of topological materials. And one could start, for example, from 2005 with the KNMLE model that predicted that in graphene, graphene is supposed to realize the quantum spin hole insulator phase. Unfortunately, spin-orbit interactions are very weak in graphene, so this is not something that one can observe in practice. But nevertheless, quantum spin-hole effect was then observed in the mercury telluride quantum wells, and then came the three-dimensional analogs of this effect. So what we call Z2 topological insulators, then came topological crystalline insulators, gapless phases like Dirac semimetals, Weyl semimetals, nodal line semimetals, then higher-order topological insulators. Now there is all these fragile phases and so on. There is quite a diversity of different phases, and then there is also there are also materials that actually realize these phases. And for us, for theorists, the nice thing about this field is that basically most of the theoretical predictions somehow get realized experimentally, and theoretical predictions are actually driving the field. Not only in terms of predicting new topological phases, but also in terms of suggesting materials. And I mean, this is what we like doing in my group. So we decided somehow to join in the middle this these efforts and contribute something from our side. Okay, but before I start with the materials, I would like to give a crash course on what are these topological invariants, what are these topological phases, and of course the most important topological invariant is the Chern number. So if you start, for example, if you take a typical condensed matter system, electrons in periodic potential, so you write block functions, and from this block functions, from the periodic part, we can obtain Berry connection, Berry phase, and Berry curvature. And Berry curvature, basically, if you think about a two-dimensional sheet, about two-dimensional Brillouin zone with the periodicity that comes from the periodicity of the lattice, so this is equivalent to a closed surface, to a torus. And if you now integrate this Berry curvature over this closed surface, we are going to get an integer number. So this is an analog of Gauss-Bonnet theorem. And this number is the Chern number. Okay, now, so if you basically want to go from Chern number 0 to 1, you necessarily need to break the surface and introduce some kind of a gapless states. And the Chern number actually describes the quantum Hall effect that was discovered 40 years ago by Klaus von Klitzing. So imagine that we have electrons confined in two dimensions. With applied magnetic field, and this brings the system in the quantum Hall state. Now, at the boundary of the states, there would be this H states that basically can propagate only in one direction, so they are chiral, and this comes exactly from the from this topological phase. So this is the consequence. A bit later, Haldane proposed his famous model that basically tells, okay, maybe there is no need in applied magnetic field, so maybe this can be realized intrinsically in materials. So he suggested this Hamiltonian that breaks time reversal symmetry, but nevertheless one can formally think of it as a topological phase in absence of magnetic field. Then for some time, not much was happening apart from the quantum Hall effect until 2005 when Kane and Mili proposed their model. So basically, the Kane-Mili model is a combination of Chern insulator with its time reversal copy. So now the topological invariant is defined modulo 2, so the so-called Z2 topological invariant nu, which can be either 0 or 1. So the model looks like this. So you have Tight-Banning Hamiltonian on Honeycomb lattice. So you have this term, which is basically the description of graphene. But now you have the second term that sums over second nearest neighbors. And you can immediately see that there is the spin operator, and then there is this quantity that tells you that electron have to move left or move to the right to the second nearest neighbor. So this is basically momentum. So this is coupling of spin to the orbital momentum, which is basically spin orbit coupling. Now, if you introduce this term, what you're going to have, you're going to have opening of the gap at the direct points of graphene. And if you, for example, calculate your system in this kind of nanoribbon or stripe geometry, you would have these edge states. At each edge, there would be a pair of them. So for spin up, electrons would propagate in one direction, and for spin down in the opposite direction. So the time reversal symmetry is respected. Now, the problem of graphene, as I already mentioned, is that spin orbit interactions are a relativistic effect. So carbon is a very light element. There is basically all the relativistic effects are very weak. And the band gap we are talking about is 25 microelectron volts. So according to first principles calculations that we can actually trust. So 25 microelectron volts is not something that one can easily observe in practice. So this didn't pick up somehow. But then quantum spin Hall effect was predicted and observed in mercury telluride, cadmium telluride quantum wells. So after the predictions of Andrei Bernevik, Shi Chen Zhang, and then the experimental confirmation comes from the group of Lawrence Mollenkamp. So that was that arrived very quickly after the suggestion of the quantum spin Hall insulator phase.
Hi, Oleg. Sorry
Yes.
for interrupting. There's one question by Ikmar. Ikmar, please go ahead.
Yeah, Oleg. So thank you for taking the time to go over these to basically provide this introduction. When I look at your Hamiltonian, you have the hopping parameter and you have the effective strength of the spin orbit coupling parameter, right? Is there a way to effectively compute this, or is this just like a parameter that...
No, there is actually a way to compute this. And I would even say that DFT predictions provide very very accurate, I mean, very, very trusted results.
Okay.
There was a little bit of confusion. I mean, in the very early works about graphene specifically, because we are computing such a small gaps. One needs to take care of the spin orbit. And in graphene, it's also some sort of a second order effect. I mean, it's so small because of some symmetry cancellation. But now, I mean, about this 25 microelectron volts, we are pretty sure. Of course, there might be some external factors like, I mean, so this is computed, for example, for ideal flat graphene. If you start introducing any kind of ripples, any kind of out-of-plane disorder, I mean, that slightly enhances the spin-orbit coupling. But nevertheless, so for ideal flat graphene, we're absolutely sure that this is 25 microelectron volt. And we know how to calculate spin-orbit interactions very accurately.
Okay, thank you.
Accurately enough. Okay, thanks for the question. I will come back to this point when we approach the heavy elements. So now, in order to calculate this Z2 topological invariant for a system that has inversion symmetry, all what we need to know are the parities of the populated states in time reverse invariant momentum points. So basically, so those are the points that that brought to themselves if you inverse momentum and reverse momentum, and then basically in 2D there would be four such points. In 3D there would be eight such points, and then you simply need to apply this formula and get this Z2 invariant mu, which is either zero or one. And that immediately tells us where to look for such materials. So what we need to have is to have band inversion that is somehow happening around one or several of such time reversal invariant momentum points. So band inversion that actually exchanges states with different parities. And then you need the mechanisms that would open a band gap, because otherwise in such system is overlapping bands, there would be no gap. So, and such mechanisms provided by spin orbit interactions. Okay. So now another particularity of quantum spin Hall effect in contrast to the ordinary quantum Hall effect is that one can generalize this to three dimensions. So that basically brings us to crystalline materials, to crystalline lattices. And in three dimensions, we would expect to see surface states that probably have band dispersion like this. And there is a spin momentum locking and the corresponding spin texture. And these surface states would probably rope for the crystal all around. And now for the three-dimensional crystalline materials, we would have 16 topological classes. So there would be this the strong index nu zero. I mean, all of them are Z2 indices and three weak indices. So basically one topologically trivial class and certain number of strong topological insulators and weak topological insulators. Now, of course, that was this picture was stimulating for a while researching these materials, first of all, because this kind of spin texture and spin momentum locking provides suppressed backscattering for charge carriers, so one can hope to observe some interesting transport properties. And also charge current means that creates spin polarization and vice versa. So there was a hope that such materials could be interesting for spintronics, for example, and there is a number of other ideas, but I'm not going to go too much into detail. So first bulk topological insulators arrived. First of all, we were speaking about materials like bismuth selenite and bismuth telluride, but then came also ternary materials like thallium bismuth selenite, also lead materials, germanium materials, and these materials actually have a lot in common. So first of all, structurally, they're somehow similar. So they all seem to be layered materials with kind of bismuth or antimony involved. They would have band gaps of several hundred milli-electron volts, so typically, let's say 0.3 electron volt, but not much larger than this. Typically, the topological insulator phase would be confirmed by ARPAS experiments, and you would see one single Dirac cone at the gamma point of the surface brilliant zone. So there was lots of similarity. Now, bismuth, of course, is for a good reason here, because in principle, we are speaking about spin-orbit interactions as relativistic effect, and more often you would find the statement that the strength of spin-orbit interactions is increasing as e to the fourth. Well, I mean, this is not entirely true, because this is from a textbook exercise on hydrogen-like atoms. So atoms with only one electron. If you put all the electrons in the atoms and you act in a charge-neutral setting, then this is more like z square, and this comes in the vertical direction of the periodic table. Now, in the horizontal direction of the periodic table, if you, for example, take valence electrons across the periodic table and you compute spin orbit splitting for them, for pip, for d electrons, you typically find a picture like this. So actually, along the rows of the periodic table, the growth is faster, but then as you fill shell and go to the next shell, I mean, kind of reset. So you have this kind of sawtooth behavior. And again, I would like to make a statement that we actually able to predict with DFT very accurately spin-orbit couplings, because for atoms, we know very well the values and we can calculate them with DFT and we find good correspondence. So now if we look at this periodic table, bismuth is here, right? The next one is polonium, which is not practical at all. So bismuth is the last element in periodic table that still has stable isotopes, and it has the strongest spin-orbit interactions in its pi shell. So we are speaking about atomic spin-orbit splitting of 1.9 electron volt, and this is actually what is deciding spin-orbit effects in the solids. So to a large extent, this spin-orbit splitting, I mean, the atomic spin-orbit splitting is transferred to the to our crystalline materials, and 1.9 electron volt, which means that the spin orbit interactions start computing with the typical values of band gaps, bandwidths, and this is not just a perturbative effect. Okay, so one can actually do this calculation, for example, for bismuth selenide, and if you compute bismuth selenide without spin orbit interactions, you actually find very nice semiconductor with some small band gap of something like 0.2 electron volts. So those are pi z orbitals of bismuth, those are pi z orbitals of selenium, and then if you introduce spin orbit interactions, I mean, there is some kind of a competition between the crystal and ligand field effect and the spin orbit spin-orbit coupling. So what spin-orbit does, it lowers this bismuth band by something like 0.5 electron volt, and you emerge in this kind of band inversion setting. So you can easily see that there is this very typical camelback shaped band. So this is a signature of band inversion. So somehow even the band gap that we are observing in this case is compares well to the experimental results, and this is simply because the gap is due to spin orbit interactions, and spin orbit interactions we can predict more or less confidently. Now, of course, bismuth selenide, this we already know in materials, and we decided back in 2013 to start our own efforts in high throughput search for new materials. And what we do, and what actually many other people do, is the following. So you start with databases of known crystal structures, like for example ICSD or COD, and if you now aggregate all the data, you removed all the duplicates, you remove the materials with fractional populations, you end up with something of the order of 100,000 materials of unique crystal structures, which is actually not such a big amount of data. Then you can do pre-screening based on, for example, spin orbit strengths or space groups that you're interested in on chemical composition, and then you simply start doing EFT calculations for all these materials, and you try to automatize this procedure. Now, from the DFT calculations, of course, you would get band structure, band gaps, but what is interesting for us are, of course, the topological invariants. Now, if the system is centrosymmetric, already explained, this is a trivial task. We need just to compute parities. If the crystal structure is non-centrosymmetric, then we need to do something more sophisticated, and there is an algorithm that was suggested by Alexei Selenov that is called Z2PAC. So this is what we used in our high throughput protocol. And then basically this allows us to identify candidate materials, and as long as they suggest DFT predictions, we are not speaking about discoveries. So these are just candidate materials. Now we can do two things. We can either do another round of refinement of results, for example, do calculations with some more expensive and more accurate methods like GW, or we can already compute some of the, let's say, experimental signatures of the topological phase and come to our experimental colleagues and make them interested in the material we somehow found in the candidate material.
Yes. Ole, sorry for interrupting. There's one question in the chat, mm-hmm. which is, what is the magnitude of the error in the calculation of the band gap?
Okay, so this varies broadly across materials, right? And it also, so we do not try to assess the error. I mean, it's extremely difficult to put error bars on DFT calculations. Because for different classes of materials, that will be slightly different error. I mean, one can do statistics, but I will show one graph afterwards, so that probably explains you, let's say, gives a good feeling of the approximate order of magnitude of these errors. But let's wait. I mean, it will come in 2 minutes, or maybe in 10 minutes. So, and then basically we started collecting this database in 2013. 3 years ago, we made it publicly available. So basically it contains data from ICSD and COD. There's roughly 13,000 something unique entries. So pre-screened materials, I mean, that has not too large supercells. We, for example, don't consider materials with even number of electrons, because those would be necessarily metals, and there are no lanthanides, for example, no F elements. And otherwise, there is more than 4,000 materials that have non-trivial Z2 indices, and from that point of view of topological physics, they're all interesting. So this is freely available on Materials Cloud. So Materials Cloud is a platform that is set up by NCCR Marvel, the Swiss national project on computational materials discovery. So you can just easily go type this URL and access to the database. So basically there is a kind of a search form that allows you to search, for example, by chemical composition, space groups, I don't know, band gap formula, Z2 indices. So everyone is invited to look for this. Now, from the point of view of data, there is actually not so much data. You can find input and output files for our calculations. You can also see the band structure and the Z2 indices. And sometimes for non-stoichiometric structures, we also give information about the hybrid vanilla charge centers, so for the Z2 pack scheme. But nevertheless, we figured out that the experimental scrolling through the data can find many interesting things. And we are glad to see that people all around the world browse through this database and profit from it somehow. Now, of course, we are not alone here. I would not talk about the efforts from other people about topological quantum chemistry, for example, of Andrei Bernevik, or about the database from Beijing. In a sense, our database is a more brute force effort. We just calculate this topological invariance in a straight way. So there is no elegant theory developed by us behind this, but nevertheless, it's still extremely useful, and we did find new materials. And now, of course, I would like to talk a little bit about the materials that we actually found. And in the very beginning of basically collecting this database, there was one material that we found. So this was beta phase of bismuth iodide. And the material has this kind of an interesting crystal structure. So it has quasi one-dimensional crystal structure composed of this kind of ribbons. So blue atoms here are bismuth, the purple ones are iodine atoms. And then they are basically stacked by van der Waals interactions. So this material was synthesized a long time ago, didn't attract any attention. And Gabriel Otes, my postdoc, who started this project in the database, he found that this material is supposed to be weak topological insulator with those Z2 indices. So that comes from the band inversion at 2 time reversal invariant momentum points. There is a small band gap, and this is how the band structure looks like. Okay, now at this point, people look at this band structure and tell me, there is something wrong with this band structure. There are no bands crossing in it. I mean, probably something really wrong with your calculations. No, the band structure is correct, and the fact that the bands are not crossing is exactly because of very strong spin orbit interactions coming from bismuth. So what spin orbit interactions do, they tend to lift certain band degeneracies. Now, if they're as strong as the bandwidths in your material, and then there are many bands crossing. So basically, spin orbit interaction totally messes up your band structure and removes many, many of the band degeneracies, especially if you're going along the high symmetry path. So that was not a mistake. Now, what a weak topological insulator means. So weak topological insulator means that the system can be thought as something that is equivalent of stack of 2D topological insulators of the quantum spin hole effect systems. So you would have kind of stacks of these edge states on the side surfaces, but on the top and on the bottom surface, those would remain gapped. And from the point of view of the band dispersion of these side surfaces, you would observe not a Dirac-on, but was something that we decided to call Dirac-groove. So there is linear dispersion along one direction and let's say very weak dispersion along the other that direction. Now we can go to our DFT calculations, compute for this particular material, and then at the gapped surfaces, which are 001 surfaces, we would find something like this. So there is a gap. And at the side surfaces, we would have this typical dispersion something that is linear along KY and very much unpronounced dispersion along the other direction for the surface. Okay, so we came with this prediction to our experimental colleagues, and well, very likely I had a friend in Dresden, Anna Isaeva. She now moved as a professor to Amsterdam, I think. So she knew exactly how to synthesize this material, so she had experience with it, and then she sent us this sample of these little shiny crystals. You know, as a theorist, I was very much excited to receive a sample and ample with some crystals. And then I started bothering colleagues around with this. So we did a little bit of characterization with EPFL. Okay, the TM characterization was done again. So through Isaeva, we can see that actually it's a material of very good crystalline quality. The crystals are very small, but the quality is good. From the point of view of transport measurements, it does behave like a semiconductor with a small band gap. So for the activation energy, we measured like something like 36 millielectron volts. So far, so good. But of course, to show there is something topological, we need RPS measurements. And such RPS measurements were done by Luca Marischini at LS in Berkeley. And these were really the first picture that he has sent to us. And that made me very much excited. So you see, I mean, there is like a very clean crossing of two bands that goes all the way to the Fermi level and crosses pretty much at the Fermi level. And then you, for example, can deposit potassium, so you can lift the Fermi level, you can dope the system, and then you expose the crossing as such, which looked very clean and nice. And we almost started celebrating and opening a bottle of champagne when we realized that actually what we are measuring, what Luca has measured, is not what we are predicting for two reasons. Well, first of all, the surface that is actually measured is 001 surface. So the surface that is supposed to be gapped. Well, we see a very nice crossing here. And the dispersion of these states don't look like this would be this Dirac groove dispersion, but instead it's a very much an isotropic Dirac cone. Okay, at this point you start wondering whom to blame, and of course we need to blame our DFT predictions for this. Okay, let me remind you that in density functional theory, all the complexity of electron-electron interactions we are sweeping under the carpet in this term, which is called exchange correlation potential, and that depends on energies. And by construction, density functional theory is supposed to work well for ground state properties, which means structural, cohesive, vibrational, and so on. But excited state properties like photoemission, band gaps, and so on, optical properties are not supposed to be treated well with density functional theory. Well, there are of course ways to go one level up, and one of them is, for example, to do the so-called GW approximation calculations. So in GW approximation calculations, you are replacing this exchange correlation potential with the energy-dependent self-energies, and this is how you're calculating the self-energies in this GW scheme, and that actually fixes many of the problems of density functional theory. Now, this is the promised slide, I took from a paper of that basically discusses the the accuracy of GW results in comparison to DFT results. And so these are calculated band gaps. You also see experimental band gaps for a broad range of semiconductors and insulators. And you can see that DFT is underestimating the band gaps, sometimes by several electron volts. And this is really like a very inhomogeneous underestimation. So the particularity here, we are discussing materials that are not direct bandgap materials. So we are discussing band inversion systems. And what does this mean? So if we start with DFT results and we apply our GW correction, that basically means that we are going to pull conduction band off the valence band. And if we are dealing now with band inversion system, that basically means that we are, by pulling conduction band off the valence band, we are diminishing the, the region in momentum space in which the this band inversion is taking place. And at some point, in the end, if you fully separate conduction band and the valence band, we would appear in the topologically trivial regime. Now, what actually happens is that, density function 3 sort of exaggerates band inversion. So there is some sort of propensity to make materials topological in density function 3. Now, if you apply GW correction to our material, what happens is that band inversion vanishes at one of the time reverse invariant momentum points, namely at the M point, but it still survives at the Y point. Now, what does it mean if you now put back all the disparities into this formula for the Z2 indices? You actually find out that the GW calculations now change the Z2 indices. Now we are dealing with the strong topological insulator, so there is one in the beginning for the strong index, and we predict some very small band gap for this material with these new calculations. Now we can redo our calculations for the expected dispersion of the surface states. We find this, so this is very much anisotropic Dirac cone. So the surface states are living somewhere here, and that basically now can be compared to the experiments. Okay, now if you compare new calculations with the experiments, this is what we find, and you can immediately see that the agreement is actually very good. Now, one should not be mistaken by saying that this is all like surface state. Of course, we are speaking about the band gap, which is somewhere here. And this is what we are supposed to see here. So this is the conduction, the valence band, and these are the surface states. And the challenge, of course, is to resolve the surface states, say that there is no band gap. And in order to do so, we had to go to the group of Alexandra Lanzar. So she has this kind of CXCV laser RPS setup in which you actually have much better momentum resolution than in the experiments that you typically do at synchrotrons. And we still see the crossing, so there is still no gap resolved. And if you go to the energy dispersion curve, you actually realize that there are two components that contribute to intensity here. So if one is the valence band, then the other one must be surface states. So that was the proof that for the absence of the gap and for the surface states, that made one of the referees happy. And finally, we published this monster paper where basically my postdoc and myself, we are the series here. And these are all the experimental groups that we made joining our project and performing all these interesting experiments. It took us forever to write the paper, to coordinate everything, all the experiments. But nevertheless, I'm happy that we had this chance to lead some joint experiment theory research here. Okay, so now, of course, we found a new material that is the particularity of this topological insulator that is somehow different from the other topological insulators that we know by that time. Namely, for example, it has this very anisotropic Dirac Fermat surface states, I mean, which is in part because it has such a anisotropic electronic structure and crystal structure. It also has an advantage of having fewer defects and low charge carrier concentration. And it also opens the entire family of this bismuth halides, because for bismuth bromide and for the mixed halides, we actually figured out that they share common structural fragments, but they are packed into the crystal in different ways. So there could be more topological materials coming, but we are basically trying to push this research now already for quite a long time, and hopefully we will publish something very soon. Okay, so for the second part of my materials talk, I would like to talk about the vial semi-metals. And while semi-metals now are gapless phases that have chiral point degeneracy, so the wild fermions, and these materials would necessarily require breaking inversion or time reversal symmetry, and the manifestation of this chiral degeneracies would be, for example, fermionic surface states that are connecting projections of this of the degeneracies. There are also signatures that are supposed to be seen in magnetotransport, like the chiral anomaly. And basically, these materials came roughly 5 years ago with the discovery of tantalum arsenide family wild semi-metals. And in these wild semi-metals, the wild points resemble the Dirac fermions in graphene, right? So there you have this kind of conical intersection. Now, Alexei Soloyanov back in 2015 suggested another possibility is that if you start tilting this this wild cone, at some point the constant energy contours would open up, and this was called type 2 wild semi-metals. So there are proposed candidates for this wild semi-metals. So molybdenum telluride, the layered material, is a confirmed one. Tungsten telluride is still a matter of debate, but nevertheless, there are some suggestions. And we decided back in the days to look for other type 2 wild semi-metals in our database of materials, and we found one. And the materials that actually caught our eye were diphosphides of molybdenum and tungsten. So these materials have this kind of crystal structure that is not layered. I mean, it's really like bulk crystal structure that has a bunch of non-symmorphic symmetries. Of course, these materials were synthesized back in the days, but didn't attract any attention. If you look at the band structure, if you plot the band structure along the high symmetry path, I mean, it looks like you have hole pockets, you have electron pockets that are very well separated. Right, and that's how the Fermi surface would look like. Now, if you look at the band degeneracy specifically, you actually find that somewhat below the Fermi level in the KZ plane, there are four pairs of wild nodes. The difference of what makes this material different from the other wild semi-metals, so apart from being type 2 wild semi-metal, is that the distance between the wild nodes of the opposite chirality is actually very large. So compared to, for example, tantalum arsenide family or tungsten ditellurite, I mean, we have much larger separation between the wild nodes. So this is in part due to the fact this wild degeneracies are created, because even if you don't consider spin orbit interactions in this material, there are already plus minus two chiral charge degeneracies present in this material. And then when you add spin orbit interaction, they actually split in pairs, but these pairs have the same sign for the chirality. And this is what made this material actually very interesting. So we called this wild phase robust wild semi-metal phase because of this large separation. And that actually means that many of the manifestations of the wild semi-metal phase would be exaggerated in this material or would manifest stronger than in other known materials. Unfortunately, we did not manage to find colleagues who would synthesize this material for us. So three groups tried to do so, but none of them succeeded following the synthesis that was described in those papers. So we published a theory-only paper, and after this paper was published, there was a series of publications from other groups, for example, from the group of Claudia Felser in Dresden, who were more successful in growing samples of this material, and what they found was actually extremely interesting. So tungsten diphosphide actually behaves very strange. So it conducts almost like a good metal. So it has very very high low temperature conductivity, typical for normal metals, and also the residual resistivity ratio for this material was 25,000. So this is probably the largest value measured for binary materials, not for elemental metals, but for binary materials, that seems to be a record. Also, this material would show extremely high measured magnetoresistance. So at the fields of 63 Tesla, I think that was measured in Nijmegen, they would measure 200 million percent for the magnetoresistance. And this is extremely strange because normally if you have a good metal, then the magnetoresistance is bad. If you have a semi-metal, a bad metal, then you can achieve a very large magnetoresistance. This combines both. So In the paper of Claudia Felser, they had this plot for the conductivity at low temperature and for the magnetic resistance, and that places our tungsten diphosphide somewhere here in a very strange place on this diagram. And if you look at all those materials that show very large magnetic resistance, okay, some of them are topological semi-metals, some of them just trivial semi-metals, some of them are direct semi-metals. So seems to be a typical behavior for semi-metals to show very large magnetic resistance. Now, there is also a claim that this material has very large mean free path of something like a fraction of a millimeter. There are also papers showing that there is a hydrodynamic electron transport at low temperatures in this material. So there are plenty of papers like this. There is also a claim for observing negative resistivity at low temperature and for magnetic fields along the current direction, but nevertheless, this is extremely weird to see IV characteristics that look like this. So the paper still didn't made it out of CONMAT, but nevertheless, the measurement is here, and this could also be related to some kind of local current backflow in the hydrodynamic transport regime. So now, looking at all these properties, it's actually extremely difficult to connect them to the presence of the wild semi-metal phase. And we ourselves tried partially answering this question, at least for the magnetic resistance, but nevertheless, the ARPAS measurement that they showed later that basically the wild points that we predicted from DFT calculations are where they're supposed to be. So, and in this case, DFT calculations work absolutely fine. So there was no need to correct in anything because it's a material that is gapless. So somehow for metals, DFT typically works better. And now coming back to the last part of my talk on magnetic resistances. So we are speaking about the transverse magnetic resistance that is defined this way, and the extremely large non-saturating magnetic resistance for this material look like this. So basically you have roughly parabolic increase of resistance as a function of magnetic field that doesn't show any quantum oscillations, so very weak quantum oscillations for these materials that is very close to being quadratic. And this looks actually quite strange to observe this kind of behavior for material with such an extended Fermi surface. And also, if you start now rotating the orientation of your magnetic field, so when your magnetic field is oriented along the B-axis, you have this very pronounced strong magnetic resistance response. If you rotate it away from the B-axis to the C-axis, you see basically no magnetic resistance. You have this kind of an anisotropic what is called angular magnetic resistance. So we actually tried to explain this somehow, and let me remind you the following. So magnetic resistance is related to the cyclotron motion of electrons. Now, I took this picture from the Ashcroft-Mervin. This is what I'm giving in my lecture on solid state physics. I actually drew exactly this on my whiteboard on my iPad 2 weeks ago at the lecture. And if you consider contributions from the orbits, from the electron orbits in free electrons with spherical Fermi surface, the magnetic resistance would be zero. Exactly, because the Lorentz force is compensated by the Hall voltage in the case of free electrons. Now, if you basically break down the free electron picture, you start, for example, changing your Fermi surface, then for nearly free electrons, the magnetic resistance would first change a square of the magnetic field, but then it quickly saturates. Now, in order to have non-saturating magnetic resistance, you would basically need to combine electron and hole pockets. So you would have a compensated semi-metal. If I imagine that I have two exactly equal spherical Fermi surface pockets with electrons and with holes, then my magnetic resistance would be strictly quadratic and would never saturate. If I consider my system in the semi-classical approximation, so no quantum oscillations, only semi-classical picture. It never saturates, and this is simply because now both electrons and holes do cyclotron motion, but because the Hall voltage contributions from them would be equal but oppositely directed, so basically there is no net Hall voltage, so there is nothing to compensate Lorentz force. So for nearly compensated semi-metals, now if you, for example, make one Fermi surface pocket slightly larger than another, so you change the concentration of your charge carriers, then you start observing still non-saturating magnetic resistance, but the dependence would be not quadratic, but somehow with a slightly different scaling. And then there is also a mechanism for non-saturated magnetic resistance for the open orbit. So we need open segments for the Fermi surface. Okay, so there is absolutely no topological physics here. This is all like arguments about the Fermi surface. And in order to calculate this, two of my group members, they're developing this tool, which is called Vanya tool. So it's a very much versatile computational tool that can calculate many properties, including now magnetic resistance. And we are basically dealing with the Boltzmann transport approach combined with the Fermi surfaces that you can calculate and interpolate very accurately from first principles. And in these calculations, we actually, the assumption that we are making is the constant relaxation time. So all the results we are plotting are magnetic field times the relaxation time that we assume to be a free parameter. Now, nevertheless, even in this approximation, we find that the results typically tend to agree very well with the experiments, and one can actually go back to very much textbook examples and try to explain them. So this is taken from 60 years ago. This is a Fermi surface of copper, and this is the angular magnetic resistance plot for copper. So this is something that you find in many textbooks. And Fermi surface of copper is very simple, right? We all know that. And if you now calculate magnetic resistance with our approach, we actually recover all these qualitative features in this angular magnetic resistance diagram. And with these calculations, now we can exactly tell you what stands behind all these changes in the magnetic resistance. So these are the dependencies on magnetic field now times the relaxation time. And if you now try to understand why all this maxima and minima on the angular magnetic resistance plot, we find that, for example, in this minimum, in the smallest magnetic resistance orientation for magnetic field, we have pretty much like free electron behavior, but with a little bit of compensation. Then for points B and C, for large magnetic resistance, we have mostly open orbits that contribute to this large magnetic resistance. Now in this minimum D, we actually have complex behavior when compensation and open orbits to sort of partially cancel each other. Okay, this is copper, something super simple, but nevertheless showing this kind of very curious angular magnetic resistance diagram. Let's come back to our material. So for tungsten diphosphide, we actually do recover this nearly quadratic magnetic resistance behavior for magnetic field along the V-axis and no magnetic resistance for magnetic field along C-axis. So this is good. And this tells us that actually the relaxation time is supposed to be quite long in this material. And this stands behind this very strong magnetic resistance response. Now, if this long relaxation time is somehow related to topological phase, we don't know. Maybe yes, maybe not. And the curious thing here about this angular dependence of magnetic resistance is the following. So your electrons and holes for B along the B axis behave in a normal way, but if you look at the Fermi surface has this very complex shape. And what it actually means is that if your Fermi surface actually has concave segments, then the Lorentz force works in such a way that your charge carriers start moving in the opposite direction, not like you would expect them. And this is actually what is happening, is that when you tilt your magnetic field along the C-axis, the shape of your Fermi surface, the cross sections of your Fermi surface are such that your electrons actually start following the hole like orbits. So, and this totally breaks down the compensation. So that's why you don't observe any magnetic resistance. And this is a typical behavior for a metal. So, and with all this, I'm probably not ready to show you, the large series of results where we calculate magnetic resistances for many topological and for many trivial metals. And in most of the cases, we actually have very good agreement with the experimental data. And so far, all the large magnetic resistances that I experimentally measured can be explained simply from the point of view of the charge carrier compensation open orbits. So for now, we don't find any topological physics in large non-saturated magnetic resistance. And with this, I think I'm almost ready to conclude my talk. I would like to thank people who actually contributed to this research and also our theory colleagues and all the experimentalists who made all these beautiful measurements for us. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Oleg, for this really wonderful talk and for sharing these very interesting results. So we now have some time for questions, and there's already one question in the chat. And the question is it possible to dope the vital point away from the Fermi energy and check if the magnetoresistive behavior changes?
So, for tungsten diphosphide, the vital points, they are below Fermi level by something like 0.3 electron volts. So they, I would not say that they're close. They're close enough. And then if you look at the I would rather say the question whether it would be possible to change the chemical composition of this material to dope the Fermi level closer to the vital points and see what happens to the magnetic resistance. But so far I did not see such experiments.
All right, great. Thanks a lot. So I don't see any question in the participants yet, so I can perhaps ask one question. So far you were showing this prediction for, let's say, pure compounds, right?
Mm-hmm.
So would it be possible to also study alloys, like something that has, let's say, 50% molybdenum and 50% tungsten?
Yeah, good question. So unfortunately, with plain DFT calculations, of course, there are approaches, all kinds of things like virtual crystal approximation that would allow to do this, but this is not quite compatible with the software packages that we are using. So if you want to go in between tungsten and molybdenum diphosphide, which are isostructural materials, we just have to argue on the basis of, let's say, interpolating between these two situations. And actually, the band structures of these two materials are extremely similar. Probably tungsten diphosphide is easier to grow and it grows cleaner, and also spin orbit splittings are a bit larger in this material. Otherwise, they show extremely similar band structures and the positions of the vial nodes.
All right, great. Thanks a lot.
So anyway, unfortunately, alloys for now are out of our reach.
Yeah, I can imagine. So I also don't see any questions in the participants chat. So I can perhaps ask a second question. So would it be possible to see, let's say, which materials are close to a phase transition when one applies a strain? So let's say, so one does a calculation, and for that material, the system is trivial. But if one applies a strain, the system becomes topological. So would it be possible to, let's say, extend this materials database to materials that are close to be topological if one applies a strain?
This is probably easier to do to calculate. Also, introduce some kind of strain and produce a number of other band structures and calculate the corresponding Z2 invariance. So we are not doing this, but that's actually a good idea to do so.
Yeah, great, thanks. So there's one question in the chat, but Avhai, yeah,
please go ahead. Can I ask one question? Just a comment or perhaps a small question. In your first part regarding this bismuth iodine alloy, I was wondering about temperature dependence as a means also of verification of topological.
Temperature dependence of which property?
The transport, for example.
So, because for transport, you see, so this is our transport measurements. There is at larger temperatures in this regime, it behaves very much. This fits very well with the Arrhenius law. Now we still don't understand what is this feature, and this is. So there are arguments that this could be some kind of a charge density wave or something like that happening in this material. But on the other hand, this is a narrow gap for semiconductor, so we still don't understand what this feature means. But from this simple, let's say, macroscopic to terminal measurements, of course, there is no way we can conclude on the topological phase from transport properties. And for bulk materials, the problem of confirming topological phase with transport is that very often, let's say, still the transport is dominated by bulk charge carriers. If you want to observe surface states, you need to be sure that that you are free from bulk from bulk charge carriers.
So this was done on a single crystal or a single crystal?
This was done on a single crystal.
How was the dimension? I mean, I'm sorry. I did not read the paper, but I will. The
crystals are typically in length, they are maximum 3 millimeter, at least, I mean, the way we do it. And the width is for some fractions of millimeter.
So you
can still contact it with, quite comfortably.
Yeah, sure. Okay, thanks.
So the big challenge about this material was doing ARPES measurements, because you cannot mount them, they're very fragile, you cannot mount them and orient the way you want. So what was done, you basically glue the crystals, you clip the surface, and then you measure some surface, and then you try to orient this already in the ARPES machine and try to figure out which surface you're actually measuring. And the problem is that we would systematically measure this 001 surface, and it was, we never managed to find the side surface. Because this is actually, even though it's a quasi one dimensional crystal, this is really the easiest cleavage plane for this material.
It's really interesting, this one. Thanks.
Yeah, and it has this kind of a very beautiful ARPES.
So in your opinion, of course, because there are several materials, and before one rushes into calling them topological material, this verification of various experiments, I guess, has to be combined, and not just one signature, but some other feature, as just you explained, in case of magnetoresistance as well. So what are the, let's say, determinantal experiments that one can be done to really judge that states that you see is really topological?
Well, for example, ways of confirming the topological character would be doing spin ARPES measurements. Because, for example, if you are able to probe your surface state separately and you're able to show that there is this spin momentum locking, then you're done. You can say that this surface states of topological origin. Okay. But for this material with such a small band gap, this wasn't possible. Simply spin ARPES doesn't deliver this energy and momentum resolution. For bismuth selenide, where you have a comfortably larger gap, this was done very early.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so we have one more question. So Avai, can you please go ahead? I think that you can unmute yourself.
Thank you. Thank you for the very nice talk. So my question is related to the first part of your presentation where you discuss finding topological materials in the material data you have found several materials. Now, I think more than 50% of the materials are topological. But in all of this computation, one of the things I don't understand is, we still have the bismuth selenide as one of the best 3D TIs. And probably also bismuth is one of the best 2D TI candidates by layer. So at the end of all this computation process of looking at all the materials, did it yield any material candidate which is better than what we had already known?
In terms of gap sizes or quality? Well, in terms of gap sizes, unfortunately, it would be very difficult to beat nature and relativity, right? So as I already explained, bismuth has for a good reason, because it's a heaviest element with the largest atomic spin orbit splitting. So all the spin orbit effects are eventually inherited from this spin orbit splitting of atomic orbitals. So in this sense, let's say if you're saying bismuth bilayer or bismuth in, would have band gap of, let's say, 0.5 electron, well, this is really the maximum you can go. It would be very difficult to achieve larger band gaps. On the other hand, looking for material that would, for example, that would be more clean, would have less smaller concentration of bulk charge carriers. It's possible. So there would be some material that beats bismuth selenide or bismuth chalcogenides, even if you start tuning the composition to reduce the concentration of bulk charge carriers. But I don't know. We will see where it goes. It's true that bismuth still remains a popular topological insulator. On the other hand, the community is less interested in topological insulators as such right now, because people started focusing on other topological phases. Topological insulators are probably among the most interesting topological phases, also from the point of view of practical applications.
Okay, thank you.
There's another question in the chat by Alexis Baratov, and the question is, have any topo-induced surface states been confirmed by STS measurements?
For our material, I'm actually not aware that for bismuth iodide, I mean, this was confirmed with the STS measurement. We were trying to motivate some of our colleagues to do this, but I mean, apparently for this particular material, it's extremely difficult to do. Yeah, I mean, given this kind of very strange needle-like crystals, that it's impossible to grow it on any kind of surface. On the other hand, for bismuth chalcogenides, yes, I mean, if it's test, you can also observe the fact that, I mean, that the spin momentum locking results in suppressed backscattering, and so this was done again very early.
Yeah, great. Thanks a lot. So I think that perhaps it's now a good time to stop the questions part. So first of all, thanks a lot, Oleg, for this wonderful talk and for sharing with us this very interesting results. And thank you, everybody, for coming to today's talk.
Thanks a lot. I also enjoyed it, and I also enjoyed questions. So the questions were actually very, very stimulating.